Hello. So I'm Martin. Hope you can hear me all okay. Nodding there. This is actually a version of a talk I did at a similar event in Manchester a few weeks ago. So if you look really carefully, you can see Manchester Digital Festival there in very small writing. And the truth is actually having quite a lot of these kinds of sessions with people because there's so many interesting things going on right now with technology. And what I'm going to do in this half an hour is just kind of whiz through a few things that have come to my attention. I'll start off by saying a couple of words about where I'm coming from, but then a few of the interesting things that have come to my attention that might be interesting for you as well. I will mention a little rabbit bot there. That's a British robot. So you know how you kind of think that things that look like that, probably they came out of Silicon Valley. You know, maybe there's a lab in Shenzhen or somewhere that's producing them. Sheffield, that's come from Sheffield. So, you know, the idea that these things always come from somewhere else, somewhere far away, where it's maybe a little bit sunnier even than it is here today. Maybe not the case. So let's see if I can work the clicker. Oh no, I've broken it already. Doomed. I'll use the keyboard. So I'm going to talk about three things, and I thought I'd give them suitably clickbaity titles. So first off, Digital Ate My Hamster, which is about the Internet of Things. Machines Are Talking About You Behind Your Back, which is kind of all about artificial intelligence and machine learning. And Now Wait for Last Year, which is about something that's actually even more interesting. So I'm going to tease you now by saying that, and then I'm not going to tell you what it is until I get to it. So what's the day job for me? I actually work as a futurist. So that means my job is to sort of check out new technologies like the Microsoft HoloLens over there. And this is something called the Emotive Insight. You might have seen the HoloLens because it's had quite a bit of publicity. It's the augmented reality headset that Microsoft have made. There's a computer in there somewhere. So unlike a lot of, you might see something like an HTC Vive, a VR headset, where there's a massive grey cable sneaking out the back and you can't really move around too much because you'll trip over things. The HoloLens actually has it all built in, and it overlays the virtual imagery on what you can actually see around you. So think about that, you know, you're looking around the room. Let's imagine you're an industrial operative working in a power plant, something like that, where you're a car mechanic, and you're looking at a piece of kit and going, you know what, I've seen one of those before, I just can't quite wait. Get the HoloLens out, pop it on, and up pops some information, schematics, links to manuals, and maybe you conference in a friend to help you learn how to fix that car or, you know, work on that power turbine. So it's very interesting. We did that to university vice chancellors. So we got them trying this kit out a few months ago. And the Emotive Insight reads your mind. So think about that. If anybody's ever had to go for an EEG for a brain scan, they normally they put this kind of net of electrodes on your head, and it's all kind of greasy, and there's lots of gel and stuff, and it messes your hair up. This thing only has like this 6 sensors on it, and you don't need the gel. It's not clinical grade, so if you were a consultant looking to make a medical diagnosis, not so good. But it's good enough that you can fly a drone with it. So think about that for a moment. It can read your mind to the extent that you can kind of think left and think up. And I don't know how that could actually work, so I must give that a try. But this is one of my colleagues actually using it to find out what's going on in her brain. So just think about that. We tend to think that what's going on in people's minds is a bit of a mystery. And that piece of kit actually only costs £232. So for £232, we'll start to find out what's going on inside people's minds. And that's really fascinating. We gave that to the university vice chancellors as well. And that was very interesting, but that's another story. So I kind of work with things like that. I'm very privileged to, and I try and take the opportunity to come to things like this to talk about the work that we're doing, because otherwise I'd just be sat in a darkened room somewhere playing with all the tech. But in parallel, the main thing we do at JISC actually is we're your internet service provider. So when you're sat in front of a computer in a lab at the college, or when you're jumping on the Wi-Fi, we're the people that do the plumbing to get you on the internet. And we're actually one of the, with our Janet network, we're actually one of the fastest computer networks in the world. So we've got 400 gigabits on the backbone, and we're just upgrading to 600 gigabits. So you know, when you get those flyers through the door and they say, hey, broadband upgrade, you know, we're offering you 200 megabits or something. This is how all of the universities and colleges and about half of the schools in the UK connect to the internet. So that's the real focus of what we do at JISC. And we do that for about 18 million people. So that's quite a lot of people. And it's very interesting to come out and meet some of the people. And I'm going to stick around. I'll be here over lunch. So if anybody wants to have a chat about any of this stuff, do catch me over lunch. But yeah, that's our primary mission. So the VR and, you know, mixed reality, brain scanning, that's a small part of what we do. But what's this all about? Because I put these clickbaity titles up, and that's to hopefully kind of try and maintain your interest. So as I go along, you'll be like, yeah, what the heck's he on about here? This is about the Internet of Things, and it's particularly about the fact that in Silicon Valley, there are a whole bunch of venture capitalists who are there saying, right, what haven't we put a chip in yet? Like, you know, toothbrushes, and this is a real product now. This is Philips toothbrush that can tell you how well you brush your teeth. And I was very skeptical about this. I thought, this is blowing rubbish, you know, who's going to want a connected toothbrush? But I had to go and have a crown fitted. Hopefully none of you guys, you're young enough that you won't have been through this experience. It's very painful. It's very expensive as well. It costs more than the toothbrush. So if I brushed my teeth a little bit better, if I get that bit round the back where they had to fit the crown, I might have saved myself the pain of going through that dental work. And actually, it's cheaper. The toothbrush is cheaper than getting a crown fitted. And all of a sudden it started to make some kind of sense. So I was very skeptical about it, and then I thought, actually, you know what? There might be something in this. But you don't want to put a chip into everything, because there's probably a point where there are some things that just doesn't make sense. Some colleges and universities are looking at things like, well, we put a chip in each chair in the room, and then we'll know, you know, how many people use the room. Well, actually, not just that, where do they sit? A lot of places have seating that's fixed. So if we know that people habitually will kind of always sit at the back, then, you know, we need to have a word about that. And this kind of thing can give us lots of useful info. Not so sure about the fork. I don't know, does anybody fancy a fork that's connected to the internet and is reporting back on what you've been eating? This is called a happy fork. And the idea of it is, you pick your food up, put it in your mouth, and the fork is recording the fact that it's been moved around. It's recording that you're chewing, in some sense, and the gaps between you doing those things. And it's supposed to actually be able to give you some feedback about, well, do you know what, you're wolfing your food down, or, you know, maybe you're eating too much, just from the fact that it knows about your eating activity. That involves this fork. So as soon as you switch to your non-connected spoon or whatever, so you get your knife out to chop your dinner up, it doesn't know about that. It only knows about the stuff you do with the fork. So maybe that's a little bit more questionable. I could see the case for the toothbrush. The fork, maybe not. Why is this important for you guys? Well, you'll probably be doing some of this. You might well find one of the jobs that you do that someone comes along to you and says, yeah, you know, we've been thinking actually about, you know, we've got these, I don't know, tables. If the table was connected to the internet, could that be a good thing? And actually, how would we do it? And that might be quite an interesting little science project in itself. But what could we do, and how would we do it? What you don't want is to end up on something called Showdown. Has anyone heard of this? Put your hand up if you've heard of it. Ah. So Showdown is basically, it's the map of things that should never have been connected to the internet. It's like a Google for power stations, train signaling networks, all kinds of stuff that really shouldn't be connected to the internet. But people do. People do. They connect to all kinds of stuff to the internet, and not necessarily consciously. You'll get somebody in to do some work for you, maybe something that you're not an expert in, and they'll go, yep, yep, I'll sort that out for you, yep, and right, I'm done. You don't necessarily know how they've connected your kit. And you can go here, you can actually find, you can find trains, you can find all kinds of stuff. Just think, the train signaling networks in some countries are connected to the internet. What could go wrong? Not just that though, also power plants. So this is a French power station. If you can make out the red button there, what do you think the red button does? Turns the power turbine off. This is literally, this is connected to the internet, and if you knew where it was, well, it was connected to the internet, not anymore. If you knew where it was, you could just sit there and hammer the red and the green button. I'm just gonna turn the turbine off and turn it on again. Ah, what could go wrong? It's just a bit of fun. And people are doing this. People are doing this every day. So I think it's fascinating to say, well, actually, what would happen if we put a chip in this? What would we put a chip in this table? We're going to connect it to the internet. The table will tell us what's, you know, have I got something put on me? Have I been stowed away? And all that kind of stuff. You can't go too far wrong with a table. It's quite hard to, you know, attack a table and make it do something that you didn't want it to. Unless it's one of those folding ones where maybe it folds up automatically and, you know, you send it the wrong kind of data packet and it just tumbles to the ground. But a power station, a little bit more hardcore. So really, really fascinating to see that people are doing this. And if some of you, I'm sure, will go into InfoSec when you really get your careers going in earnest, and protecting things like this, finding things that should never have been connected to the internet, building systems that can be connected safely, finding things like this and fixing them, but huge, huge opportunity. We saw not long ago what the consequences can be if you screw this up. So I don't know if you remember the CoinHive crypto jacking malware that attacked a whole bunch of people's machines recently, including a lot of government departments and the NHS and even the Information Commissioner's Office, the people who are meant to make sure that your information stays where it should. The interesting thing for me though about that is that malware just silently installs itself on people's websites. So you visited, I remember which government departments are in there, let's say it's the Home Office, you visit the Home Office's website, and there's a little bit of JavaScript running in your browser which is trying to mine cryptocurrency, and you just know that your laptop's going a bit slow and it's really hot, and you know, my fan keeps spinning up, what's all that about? You don't realize that website is actually running, effectively, as a malicious piece of code on your machine. Well, I don't know, it loads up okay. What's the problem? So again, I think there's something really interesting there about, you know, think about future careers. Well, I want a browser that can tell me. I want a browser that goes, do you know what? Something's not right here. Last time I visited that site, it didn't do any of that stuff. Something's changed, and I'm not happy about it. So again, I think that's a huge opportunity. So let's talk about AI and machine learning. You hear a lot about AI, and what I want to do today is just sort of demystify it a little bit. I'm going to talk about robots as well. I wasn't sure actually if you guys, do you do any kind of machine learning type stuff in the course? Because I don't want to.
No, not directly, no. But they need to have an awareness about AI.
You can tell me if I'm off beam here, okay? So first off, I mentioned that robot, the robot from Sheffield, and the thing that we see in just because we work with all of the universities and all the colleges and quite a lot of schools increasingly is the people actually are bringing these things in as an educational tool. They're also starting to pop up in all sorts of places like high-end shopping malls. If you go to an airport, say if you go to Japan, go to the mall at the airport, you'll be greeted by a robot in half the stores and in Tokyo or what have you. There are going to be a lot more of them around. I just snapped a few that I saw at a conference back in January. So that one's British. This one is from South Korea. I like to think of this one as Snailbot, but I think it has a proper name. That one's called Sandbot. And the idea of the Snailbot is that's actually, it's for helping kids to learn all about coding concepts. So you guys probably are too old to have had this at school. I've got a couple of kids in primary school, and they're learning with little robots like this that, you know, if you want to write a computer program, you sort of have to do it in stages, and there's this bit and that bit. And, you know, if you're a robot, it's probably something like go left, go forward, turn around, flash your lights. But I think that's very interesting from your perspective, because my kids are learning this at primary school, and, you know, everybody in their generation is just a thing that we do. And so by the time they get to secondary school, they'll probably be coding in Python, because you move from doing this kind of thing in Scratch to doing Python. They're going to catch you up, frankly. You know, you need to stay sharp, because they're going to catch you up pretty quick. No, I'm only kidding. But the Sandbot thing is probably the kind of robot that you're more likely to be encountering on a kind of day-to-day basis. It's designed to be the kind of robot that, you know, say you come into a mobile phone store and it glides up to you and says, oh, hi. Hi, Martin. Not seen you here for a while. Your contract's due for renewal, actually. We have some really good deals if you're interested. And, you know, that kind of interaction is very scripted right now. We talk about artificial intelligence. It's very scripted, it's very stilted, it's very artificial. And that will change. And some of you will probably be working on that kind of thing. How can we take it from a robot that's following the script, and it sort of recognizes what you're saying, but it doesn't really understand it, to make it much more conversational, much more fluid, a robot that can understand variations in the things that you're likely to say. If you talk to something like Amazon Alexa right now, it's got only scope for a very limited variation in the things that it can understand. I relate back to, I don't know, if I said, Alexa, what's the weather like today? It can understand probably about 12 different variations of that. And I can't just come along and pitch up with some random weather-related phrase unless Alexa's already primed to recognize it. And the same is true for these little robots. They're very cute, but they're also very limited right now. And you could change that. This is my favorite, though. That particular event is Microsoft bought Minecraft, so Microsoft have put the full power of their marketing machine into promoting Minecraft. So they had like cardboard pigs and plushies. I don't know what those two are up to there. Doesn't look good. But they have a programming environment, Minecraft EDU now. So again, thinking about where my own kids are coming from, they're probably too old now to be exposed to this. But rather than learning Python or Scratch, actually I think a lot of kids in primary school will be learning to code in Minecraft, which is pretty mind-blowing, really. But I said I was going to talk about AI, and when people talk about AI, they usually mean machine learning, but then there's another bit to it, which is AI is just something that a computer can do that seems impossibly smart. I can't imagine how it does it, and it, you know, it's almost as though a human being is there behind the scenes driving it. But the real action for a computer scientist is machine learning, it's neural networks. And this is a guy who's done a brilliant blog post. We'll share these slides later, so you don't need to scribble this down. Brilliant blog post where he says, right, okay, loads of people are talking about this. It's a really big deal. Machine learning, neural networks, foundation of AI. How the heck does it work? And he said, right, I'm going to set myself a challenge. The smallest bit of machine learning code that I can possibly write and squeeze it down to absolute minimum. So he managed to squeeze it down to 11 lines of Python. And if you've done any Python, you'll know this is a little bit of a cheat, because he's using a library called NumPy, which he's not importing there. So there is a little bit more. And actually, it's pretty obfuscated. So if you read the blog post, you'll see that there's a kind of full commented version, which is several pages long. But this version is enough to say, well, look, you know, I can fit that on a slide. I can fit it on a slide that you can read at the back of the room. It's not that hard. So if you think AI, machine learning, maybe I should check that out sometime. It's not that hard. If you fit it onto one slide, this is very simple neural network, just recognizes noughts and ones. You can do this. You can do this because you can go to this web page and you can click on it. You can read how he did it. You can copy his code. There's a lot more like this, which is just his open source code. People have put blog posts up. People have published scientific papers. You can just copy it and try it yourself. And this will run on a Raspberry Pi, so there's no excuse. You know, you can nip out and buy a Raspberry Pi Zero for a fiver, and you can go and run this on it. So don't need a supercomputer. So if you're interested, do have a play. What I'm most interested in is a lot of the AI that we see, a lot of the machine learning is about recognizing things. So like if you're a self-driving car, is that you know, a cat that stepped out in front of the car? Ooh, if it is, I better stop. Things like that. We're starting to see a lot of AI which is being used to generate stuff, and that's where I think it gets really interesting. So this is a schematic of a generative neural network, and actually it's two neural networks. There's one that recognizes things, like the cat jumping out the front of the car, or the noughts and ones in that bit of code. But there's another one that tries to make things. And this is the incredible thing about artificial intelligence, the state of the art right now, is this generator network here. You can feed it anything, you can feed it white noise, and it'll try and produce something. And the other neural network, they've called it the discriminator, will say, yeah, that's no good, try again. And the one on the left there will keep iterating, will keep trying new stuff out. And no one really knows how that works. No one really knows, no one really understands how that works. But you can get some amazing results. And people use them every day. You probably use them every day because you use things like Snapchat filters. And you're just there going, yeah, I'll just put a filter on this. You know, I fancy a pirate hat today or whatever. I'm going to give myself you know, a false beard and glasses. And behind the scenes, this thing called artistic style transfer is happening, where they're just saying, well, okay, you know, we'll have that dog in the style of that picture, something like that. There's a little bit of generative AI going on there. And again, you can play around with this. This website here, Deep Dream Generator, lets you play around with it. But there never was that picture. That picture is entirely artificial. It's made by taking the painting and the photo of the dog, munging them together, doing a bit of generative AI. You can use this to make films now as well. So you can take a video clip and say, I'll have it in the style of X. So I have this video clip, but in the style of, I don't know, Picasso, something like that. Really fascinating. My favorite, though, is cats, because I've been on the internet for a while, and I know the internet is really all about cats. So, or YouTube videos of cats, particularly. Here's a neural network which generates pictures of cats. So you draw a little sketch, here, and it produces a cat that roughly maps onto your sketch. It's called Edges to Cats, and again, this is all code that you can download, you can copy, and you can play with. You can also, because you can just draw a picture, if you draw a monster, you get a cat monster, which is brilliant. It does a few other objects as well. It does things like shoes and handbags and buildings. Your contribution, you could make it do something else. So, I don't know, cars. I'd quite like to see a car monster. That would be pretty good. But these pictures are generated by an AI. And that code is all out there for you to play with. Same guy who did the little condensed bit of code has also done generative AI experiments, where he does things like feeds the entire works of William Shakespeare into one of these networks and then says, okay, make me some stuff that looks like Shakespearean text. I'm not Shakespearean enough to know whether that's plausible or not. It looks quite good. It's got, you know, Shakespearean type language in it. Could you get it to the point where you could convince somebody who was a Shakespearean scholar that they would come along and go, the missing text, Shakespeare's lost play, we've found it. I think they would look at this and they'd go, nah. But maybe you can change that. This is my favorite bit of generative AI though. This is an AI from the guy who did the William Shakespeare stuff. It makes Linux kernel code. So Danger Will Robinson, it makes Linux kernel code. And I think it now compiles as well, which is good. When he first did it, it didn't compile. But now it does. So, you know, sorry, you're obsolete. actually. I was geeing you up and saying, look, you've got a great career ahead of you. One of you is going to figure out how to make this generate useful kernel code, and then you'll just be able to say, okay, I've, I can't be bothered writing all this code, just get the AI to do it. So there's a challenge. But this really does, it makes it, it's been trained on the entire Linux kernel source code, and it will just sit there and go, bing, I've made you a bit of Linux kernel module there for you to play with. It's even got spelling mistakes in the comments, so it's just completely realistic. So my final one, I don't know, how am I doing for time?
10 minutes.
Perfect. Yeah, so my final one is all about space. So obviously Leicester is big on space anyway, and it seems like there's rarely a week goes by without a space announcement. Does anybody know about the UK spaceports? Has anybody heard about these? So there won't be any near Leicester because they all need to be by the sea, basically, because if you launch a great big rocket up into space and a bad thing happens, you don't really want it to land. Well, I don't know, maybe you do. But that neighbouring town, I've never liked it very much. Boom. Now it's gone. But generally speaking, it's deemed to be better to have them explode in midair and all the fragments to land in the sea somewhere. So these are all the places that have been bidding to be a UK spaceport. And here in Leicester, actually, we do quite a bit of work on making satellites and components for satellites. And what happens is the UK makes nearly half the satellites. They're the sort of fridge-sized satellites in the world. We already do that. And again, that could be something that some of you end up doing. But we can't launch them. We can't get them up into space. So they have to hitch a ride on somebody else's rocket. So just picture that. You make the satellite here in Leicester, and then you go, right, okay, we're going to need to get it into space somehow. Well, there's French Guiana, where Ariane launches from. There's like Cape Canaveral, you know, Vandenberg, places like that. They're quite a long way away. It would be quite handy if we could just, you know, pop it on the back of a lorry and take it down to maybe Newquay in Cornwall. There's a few locations probably a little bit less accessible there, up in the Outer Hebrides, the Shetland Islands, things like that. But still quite a bit easier than taking it to the other side of the planet. So the theory is, and this isn't crazy talk, this is actually the government. So the government does some crazy talk, but this particular bit of government talk is quite sensible. What they're saying is, if you can meet their conditions for operating a spaceport, then go for it, we'll give you a license. And that's what those sites I've put up on the map have done. Basically, they've spent the last couple of years trying to build up their case to say, do you know what? Give us a license and we can make a go of this. And that, again, that sounds a bit sci-fi. It doesn't really sound like it's going to happen. This is the consortium of companies, there's universities in there, there's major employers around one of those spaceport bits. So this is Glasgow Prestwick Airport. This feels like it's going to happen. These guys aren't just, you know, putting their name down and they're going to walk away. They want to see this happen. So I would, if I was going to make one prediction today as a futurist, this will happen. And if you're interested, there's huge opportunities for computer scientists, because these things, they fly themselves, but someone has to write the code. You know, someone has to write the code that powers the satellite. At all levels, it's driven by computer science. So, you know, huge, huge opportunities. And one I'm thinking is probably going to be the most glamorous of them is Newquay Airport's bid, because Cornwall. Richard Branson has this space plane, which is designed for space tourism. And you can just picture Richard Branson pitching up at Newquay, big toothy grin, surfboard, you know, we're going to do a bit of surfing, we're going to fly up into space. And this will happen. I'm increasingly confident about it. One of the other things that you could do is become an asteroid miner. So this is a company called Planetary Resources. They want to send robots up into space to do asteroid mining. And then you can build stuff in space with the stuff that you mine from the asteroids. You can apply now, but that means that you get to be one of the people who's building the robots. You don't get to go up into space because that's not really happening yet. But building the robots could be fun. So I was going to leave you with a question, actually. I'm a big fan of Alan Turing. I think we kind of live in Alan Turing's world. He imagined all this stuff, you know, when he was actually quite a young man, before the Second World War. He imagined all this stuff, and we live in his world now. We live in the world that he imagined. I like to think, what would Alan Turing do? We've got this little tool that we use to kind of gauge where people's comfort zone is, and that we call this visitors and residents. You won't be able to see the scale there, though, I'm afraid. It's all about, where am I happy and most comfortable, sort of technologically, let's say, and where are the areas that I just don't really, I'm not comfortable with, or I don't know about, I'm just a mystery to me. And my message to you, my closing message is, look for those areas that are new, those areas that are a mystery, those areas that you're curious about. You're going to see what you can find out about them. And I hope I've given you some interesting things to think about today. I'll put my details up. I will be around. I'm going to nip out for a call in a bit, but I'll be around for lunch. Or do hit me up by email, on Twitter, all that kind of stuff. And thank you ever so much for having me today.